Good morning. I heard you guys had an energy break, so I hope there's enough food in your tummy, because apparently happy tummy equals decent attention. So for those of you who are wondering who I am and what I do, I am Ahaana Krishna. I'm an actor. I work in the movies, because of which on most days of the week I am busy being other people. And on the other days of the week, you'll see me flipping through the pages of my advertising books from college, because apart from acting, the one other thing in which I think I have a little idea about happens to be advertising. Okay, so coming back to the point, I've got a little story to tell you all. If you ask me the genre of the story, I think it's horror. So this story dates back to 1998, when I was 2 years old. That was when my first sibling, my younger sister, was born. Like most firstborns, I disliked the sudden division of attention, this flamboyant entry of a debutant. Well, now that sounds similar to how I feel about so many new debutant heroines. No, just kidding. So as I was saying, that's what I felt like most firstborns. But unlike most firstborns, I planned to kill her. Let me remind you, I was 2.5 to be precise, and there is no exaggeration here. So I picked up my fancy poppy umbrella and I hit this barely few days old kid on her head in the hope of just getting done with her. My sister started crying and screaming at the top of her voice. My mother came running from another room and she asked me what happened. And I was quite quick enough to tell her that I hit her on the head with my poppy umbrella. My mother, feeling perplexed and picking up my sister who was crying nonstop, my mother was screaming at me. She asked me, "What is wrong with you? Why would you do that?" I said, "I saw it on TV." So back then, there used to be a very, very popular television commercial for Poppy Umbrella, which had this cool jingle that went like, "Vadigondu thalile sare, poppy kudagondu thalikyo vene," which translates to, "Sir, don't hit me with a stick, hit me with a poppy umbrella instead." So that was that. I mean, I just did that. Hardly was I done saying this, then my mother gave me a tight whack. And more tighter backs here and there. Following which, she picked up my sister and ran to my dad, and there was a lot of jazz. Touch wood, she was okay. Nothing serious happened to her. Right now, she's doing great. And fortunately for all of them, my plan bombed big time. So I'm just wondering how complex my thoughts were when I was 2. I actually thought so much about the whole thing, and I made such a big deal about it in my head. What for? Now, when I ask myself what for, I'm reminded of yet another creepy slash weird childhood story of mine. So, I can go on record to say that in the history of kids, I would probably have been the only kid who would watch Tom and Jerry only to cry at the end of every episode. Yeah, I'm not kidding. So what happened is that one day my mother casually told me that, "Ammu, your Tom and that sister of mine whom I plan to kill is Jerry. Because of course, Tom is bigger and Jerry is the smaller, cuter one." So since then, I've never seen that cartoon as Tom and Jerry. I've only seen it as me and her. So of course, Jerry is the smarter one and Jerry has to outsmart Tom at the end of every episode. That's like the rule of the game. So I used to feel like a big loser on an episode basis. So that's how complex my mind worked. Funnily so, as I grew up, the complexity of my thoughts also kept growing up. Quite often I make this joke on myself that I think the thing out of everything. Well, amidst all the self-brooding, that one thing that comforts me a little bit is the fact that most people around us are relentlessly thinking 100-odd things almost all the time. I mean, I don't mean to say that your minds are as complicated as mine was when I was 2. That's a different benchmark altogether. But what I mean to say is that it's so difficult to find somebody whose mind is like chicken clear soup. I mean, most of our minds just end up looking like one of those hot and sour chicken mancho soups that's loaded with every possible vegetable and so much of meat and noodles and all of that, like so many things. Do we really need to think so much? The limited time that we're all allotted in this world, do you think it's worth thinking about these 100 things out of which probably 80 or 90 do not make the slightest of difference to us? How much nicer do you think it'll be if we pick those 20 or 10 thoughts which actually matter and we pick, you handpick your favorite ingredients like love, laughter, gratitude, humility, empathy, grace, prudence, authenticity, anything as per your choice. You put all of them together and you just see and feel your mind looking like a beautifully kept garden rather than an absolutely unkept wilderness, like a jungle wherein a million things are there growing one on top of another. All things obscure, a total mess. What would you prefer? I vote for the former, however mainstream it could sound. You know, I feel like we're all so busy and cool that I don't remember the last time I felt my breath, like, feels nice, you know. Want to try feeling your breath? So, on certain days, we're all doing great things and we're feeling cool about ourselves. And we're doing greater things and we're feeling cooler about ourselves. And then on certain other days, we face rejection after rejection and we feel depressed, disappointed, discouraged. I feel like we're all fighting and conquering 100 battles, moving ourselves across a plethora of emotions, riding along the greatest of highs and lows, and letting all of this take a toll on us positively and negatively. Now, I'm just wondering, while we're doing all of this, just imagine that out of the blue, a coconut just decides to fall on your head. I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to be a coconut, since we're all presumably from the land of coconut trees. I just chose an example that's rather regional. It could be a lightning streak, it could be a wrongly driven car, it could even be the surprise breaking of your heels. Like, okay, that's okay. Anyways, back to the coconut. If that happens, what happens? Story over. And then, all those things that you accomplished, all those things that you were madly chasing, and all those things that you probably lost to a certain others, nothing matters anymore. Nothing makes a difference anymore. It's all a joke. Now, I don't mean to get negative here by calling life, you know, fragile or something. Because of course, positivity is the new cool. So let's be positive, if not anything, and let's begin to look at life as something very precious, something very delicate. You know, what I'm trying to say is that on our laptops and PCs, I'm sure we press on Ctrl minus minus and we zoom out, right? The same way, if you actually zoom out on life and look at all these things from a bird's eye view, then all these battles and all your plethoras and all your ups and downs, they will all begin to look like minions. Yes, minions, like small and funny. So, on, maybe not on all days, once in a while, I'm sure we all do sit down and, you know, we begin to ponder about what life is actually all about. One thing we all know for sure is that we're not going to get this book sent from this ultimate post office in heaven which explains what life actually is all about. No, we know that that ain't happening. How we usually get this understanding is that one, we figure it out on ourselves, and two, we hear of it from someone who's seen a lot more of it. So I feel like there are two options to like figure out life. One, that is option number one, is that by the time we are like 65 or 70 or 85, we begin to feel like, okay, now I have been through most of it, good and bad, and now I'm like eligible to, you know, look at the entire thing and just make a conclusion that, okay, this is probably what the whole thing is all about. That's my option number one. Option number two is, remember those 10-20 thoughts I was talking about? Take those 10-20 thoughts, select your favorite ingredients, create a clear picture in your mind as to how you want your upcoming 3-4 months to look like. And then slowly, steadily, happily, mindfully move forward. This way, you can be a little more aware of every moment you're passing through. Every moment begins to feel more wholesome, and you can actually give your attention to those things in your life that actually deserve your attention. You know, I don't know why, while I say this, I'm reminded of these mobile plans. Like option number two, which I just mentioned, is like your prepaid plans, wherein you select the plan that you like and you enjoy the benefits of it. And option number one is like your postpaid plans, wherein you keep going and going and going, and finally you get your bill. Okay, so basically over the past 10 minutes or so, I've been paragliding through big, big words and long, long sentences just to casually put across 4 points. That is number one, feel your breath a little more often. Number two, your mind feels clearly better off as a pretty garden rather than a crazy jungle. Number three, you are the chief executive chef of your life who gets to choose all the ingredients. And finally, most, and I mean most of which we go through in life are after all small and funny, just like minions. So while I speak all of this, please do not take me as a super sorted person. I am not. I'm just hanging around somewhere there. I am my instrument of change. I am my guinea pig. And, you know, while I speak to all of you, just as much as I aspire to make a difference to at least one of you, I aspire to make a difference to myself as well. It's been a pleasure talking to all of you. Thank you. Oh, and by the way, one more thing. I still, like, even till date, I have my doubts that if it was the way of the universe of punishing me for having that creepy idea with just one sibling, that sooner than I knew came 2 more siblings and my entire house looked like some sort of a nursery school with the 4 of us. Like, seriously, I mean, but jokes apart, I'm so grateful for those 3 girls, my 3 sisters. Today, if I'm able to speak in front of a crowd, it's purely because I've always had an audience at home. I'm just wondering why I actually thought so much when I was 2. I could have thought of which cartoon to watch or which ice cream to eat instead. So let's zoom out on life. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure talking to you.